I'll be talking about how to become a freelance web developer in 2021. In the past few years, I've been doing freelance development myself, and I've had different clients, backend, frontend, full stack, web development essentially. And I've learned a lot in terms of how do you choose a client, how do you find a client, how do you even choose the salary? Because that is like the biggest thing, is not knowing what to charge a client. And when I was just starting out to work as a freelancer a couple of years ago, I made quite a lot of mistakes. Like with one of the clients I had, the first one, the mistake I made was I was just texting with them, simply exchanging messages, emails, but that's not the type of communication you actually want to have with them. So I decided to share what I have learned while I was doing a freelance web development, and hopefully it's gonna help you once you'll be going into 2021 to find the right clients, to have the right approach with them, as well as choosing the right salary. But first, if you're new to this channel, I'm DevPool. My whole purpose is to help beginners and juniors to succeed in the tech industry through my experience. If you're not subscribed yet, consider doing so, because I'll be talking about software development, how to be a competitive developer, as well as giving out career tips and advices. So here's tip number one. When you go into freelancing, make sure you learn as many tools as you can. Each section of web development, like front-end, back-end, design of it, has different tools, as well as each of those sections evolves rapidly. For the front-end, you'll find that they'll use a lot React, Vue.js, Angular.js, and you do want to familiarize yourself with all of those technologies, or at least pick one that you really, really like. So if you already know React, try to stick with it as much as you can. Of course, whenever you look for a client, just make sure that their stack that they have currently is on React. And it's pretty much the same thing goes for a backend, where if it's Node.js, you'll use Node.js. If it's PHP, you'll be using a PHP. But when it comes to tooling, I don't mean just writing a frontend, backend, but actually it is to know how to design the system. Whenever you write code and you push it, you want to make sure it automatically deploys from your branch to the server, as well as setting up the server itself, making sure that whatever the code you write, it doesn't just work on your machine. And what I mean by that is, what we use is Docker. So if you're not sure what the Docker is, essentially it's just has a bunch of containers for a different purpose of an application on the backend side. And you can change those containers as many times as you want. Let's say one of them could be like where your API is, and it's written using Node.js. So if you don't like that, you can just simply delete that container and replace it with the PHP. If later down the road somebody else would join your team, they can just download your repository and they'll just run a Docker Compose up, and that's it. The system will be exact same. It should work in exact same way as what you have on your machine currently. Point number two, and that is building your personal website. The reason why you want it is you want to build a trust with your clients. I mean, if I'm your client right now and you're telling me you're a freelancer, how do I know that? Like, if there's a website that I can go to and visit and I can see what you have out there, I'll have a better picture of you as a developer if you're able to create my specific website or not, as well as I'll be able to see what you've been up to. And with that website as well, you can build your social presence. So there are different websites I'll be talking about later, like Upworks is where you can just say, yeah, this is the website I have built, that's my personal website. So the clients can go visit, take a look at what you have in there. Tip number three, and that is identifying what type of services are you offering to your clients. And that is very, very connected to tip number two, because when I go on your personal website, I should be able to see that information as what your services are. So then I know, okay, this type of a developer, I can see he can build me a front end, I can see he can build me a back end, but he or she doesn't really have experience with web design, which I'm okay with. Tech field is moving super fast. Web development and all of its tools are changing every day. What we had this year may not be next year. So whenever something new comes out, try to learn it as fast as you can. Because when you'll be sitting in a room with a client and then they're gonna ask you a question if something is possible, with the new technologies that could be coming out that you're not aware of, that problem could be solved, let's say, in 1 day, 2 days. But since the technology you know is old school, It's gonna take you a lot more time to finish it. It could take you 4 or 5 days. But then what happens is now you're gonna have to maintain something old. And you don't want to maintain something that is old because it's just going to be hard on you. And at the end, you're gonna just end up throwing that away anyways. So whenever you're building up a new project, make sure that you're using the latest tools that there is. Tip number 5, and that is you're gonna have to register as a business at specific state that you're located in. And the reason why is because when you'll be working for a specific client, well, you're actually working with the client because right now you're not being employed by them. You're not working there full time. You're not working for them, but you're actually working as a business. What you have right now, what you're setting up is business, which means that every time you're having a contract with a client, you're getting paid. You have to write that information down. Everything, whatever happens, the transactions, whatever it is, whatever your business expenses are, all of those things, you need to write it down. And the reason why is because when you'll be doing taxes, that is the information you have to provide to show how much money you have made last year. Even if you're just working as a full-time, not as your corporation, you still have to provide that information to the government yearly. Even if you made $0, if you made nothing last year, you have to show that. So that is something for you to keep in mind. And I'm not entirely sure how the things work where you are located. So what I'll suggest is for you to read information on what state you're located in, what country you're in, because that rule is different for different countries, different states. I'll encourage you to take a look at what you can do, what are your options, and what do you have to do as a business. Tip number 6. And that is looking for clients. The tools that I'm using is Upworks. I kind of like it, I kind of hate it, because it depending on what type of a client you're gonna get from there. At first, as you're starting out, it's going to be super difficult to find a client. So what I'll recommend for you to do is, once you've set up your profile in there, try to apply to as many jobs as you can, to as many clients as you can. And the one good thing about that is actually it will help you to learn a very, very important skill. I would say 2 skills. Number 1 is project management, and number 2 is communication. And don't worry if you never had clients or you never had the business type of communication, because that place is perfect for that, to learn those 2 skills. The type of project you should be choosing are the ones that have a really good pay, where you can see they offer you, like, let's say minimum of $1,000, or let's say it has a really good like hourly rate. And I'll be talking about that as my last point. And when you take a look at job postings, read their description fully and carefully, because for some of them, what I specifically like is they write really good details on what the job is, what tools you have to use, what to expect from there, really. And you want to know that because it tells you how, number 1, serious they are, and number 2, are they going to pay you money? That is really important for you. Tip number 7, last one, and that is to know how much you should be getting paid hourly. Well, the website I use to identify how much I should be getting paid hourly first is, I use Hello Banzai. I'm able to put my information there in terms of what type of work I'm doing, so web development, how many years of experience I've been having, as well as what is my location. And it will draw you a chart of how much you should be getting paid hourly. And another thing what I do, or the way I charge my clients, is I keep on practicing the new skills in the way that I time myself, actually. So let's say I wanna build out a new feature, and that is just simple registration feature. I want to see how long it took me to set up the entire flow of registration. If I know it took me like an hour, 2 hours to set it up, depending of course on what language I used, I'll keep that record for the future. Because when I'll have a client and they're gonna ask me a question, so how long will it take you to do a registration part, for example? Well, based on my previous data, I'll be able to say it's gonna take me 2 hours. And of course, since you're monitoring all that information about yourself, how fast you can code and deliver specific features, that is what also your salary will be based on. As you're getting more experience, as you keep on doing freelancing year over year over year. Right now you may start off as, for example, let's say $30 an hour, But then that number could easily go up to $40, $50, $80 an hour. Questions of the day. What type of clients are you planning to take on? Do you already have a personal website or not? Leave your answers and possibly links in the comment below. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.